practicing up there one day, and all the big, Leon and all of them were coming from Whitey's funeral. I never really met him. I never knew him at all. The gentleman that ran everything then was, his name was Charles Buchanan. And he was the one that was running everything. Anyone else? Yes.
I was wondering how many years you danced at the Savoy.
I danced at the Savoy from 1948 until it closed 1958. I was on the road after I went to Harvest Moon Ball, which was in 1955. And Sonny Allen, he won in 58. Sonny Allen won Harvest Moon Ball, and he started a dance troupe. And I was like one of the first ones to dance with him. Let me tell you a story about Sonny. Sonny came up to Savoy one night, and we used to have, you've heard of the circle, right? You dance in the circle. They have a circle where all the good dancers would dance. Because one girl, a couple would start dancing, and when they make this circle, and she might dance with 10 guys before that song was finished. Every time one would spin around, another one would grab her. And you just kept right on dancing with whoever grabbed you. And Sonny came into the circle, and he grabbed me. And I said, oh, I don't want to dance with you. He said, why? I said, you can't dance. So we knew who could, who couldn't, who was new, you know. So we didn't take any chances. You don't want to look bad, you know. So he says, one day you're going to be working for me. I said, yeah, in your dreams. Well, in 1958, but I helped teach him when he won the Harvest Moon Ball. And the girl that he won with, she moved out of the city like 2 or 3 days after they won the Harvest Moon Ball. He had gigs to do, the Ed Sullivan Show, and you get club dates, you sign contracts. For all of this, the night you won the Harvest Moon Ball. And so he had a girlfriend, and so we had to rush and teach her, because she had just like started dancing just a little. We rushed to teach her his routine, and they did the gigs, and then he decided he wanted to start a troupe with 8 girls, and that's what Sonny did. Got 8 girls together, and we rehearsed for 8 months, like 12, 16 hours a day. That's how we rehearsed before he took the first job. He said, I want you perfect. Whatever the agent wants in dancing, I want you to be able to do that. We did tap, we did African, we did modern, we did jazz, Lindy, and we did, we did show tunes, you know, we did a whole score of Gypsy. With all the changes, anyone has ever heard Gypsy, there's a lot of changes in the music. And we did the whole score of Gypsy. I made these costumes, these fabulous costumes. We had plumes and we had feathers on the hips and these tight little corset-type outfits. And we did a very classy act. And we opened at Small's Paradise, which was in Harlem. It was a couple of blocks over from the Savoy. And the reason why we opened there, because our families wanted to know, what the heck have you been doing for 8 months? So we opened there, all our families came to see the show. And so many people, the band leaders there and the owner of Small's, so he said, you don't belong up here in Harlem. You belong on Broadway. And we tried, Sonny tried, to book us, you know, down on Broadway as a musical, but it never materialized. And finally, he had to break the girls down to 4 girls in order to get us jobs. And we worked all over the United States and Canada for about 13 to 15 years. We were up and down the highways and flying here and flying there. We worked in Red Fox's club. He brought us out there. Red Fox was my godfather. And we worked with him in Boston on a show. And when he saw the show, it was at Basin Street East. He said, I've got to have you in my club. And that was before he got the club. And when he got the club, which was called Red Fox, it was on La Cienega in Los Angeles. And when he got the club, we got a telegram with tickets to fly to LA. We took turned them in. He said, we're going cross country. We want to see. He said, take your time getting here. I'll bill you when you get here. We turned the money in and got Greyhound bus tickets because we wanted to see the country. And we went by bus, and he was having a fit. He didn't know what happened to us. And he called our parents, and, well, they left here at such and such a time. We left on a Sunday. We got there Wednesday on Greyhound bus. And he had a chauffeur. We had a chauffeur, chauffeur-driven limousine to take us any place we want. He had our rooms and everything all set up at a motel. And each one had their own place. And we were there for 3 months at his club. And we had crowds on top of crowds. It was a beautiful gig.
What year was that?
I was there. Oh, yes. What year was that? Oh, gosh. I don't know. But anyone that got my bio today, anyone got one of my flyers? Did you get one of my flyers, Chris? Okay, I think it's in there when we were in the Red Foxes. And we stayed there for 3 months. And what killed the gig was the assassination of Martin Luther King. That killed the gig. You know, everything just stopped still. And the clubs closed for a couple of days. And we didn't even go in the street because we didn't know what was going on. Those crowds and everything. People everywhere, and the police were stopping you if you go to the gas station to buy gas. They would go with you to make sure you're putting it in a car and not making Molotov cocktails. Because this happened after they burned down in L.A.? Watts. Right. This happened after they burned down Watts. So they didn't want another Watts. So they would follow you, you know, to the gas station, make sure you was putting gas in a car when you went to get gas in a can or something. And we stayed closed for a couple of days. Then we opened back up. And we tried and tried, and nobody came out, you know. Because we were getting all of the stars were bringing crowds of people to see us, you know. They were coming with parties of 30, and parties of 40, you know. Oh, you got to see these girls. These girls are terrific. And there's only one guy dancing with them, you know. And because we did different things. We sang. We danced, we tap danced, you know, we did a little comedy. We had one girl, she was a stone comedian. She couldn't dance, but she was a good comedian, and she would play it off, and everybody loved her. So we did the gig. We stayed there for maybe another month until we realized Red Fox was paying us out of his pay that he was making in Vegas. So we decided that we didn't want to do that. I know you all have heard of Norma Miller. He brought her out on the same show. She was on the same show. But she stayed because she was only one person. He made her into a comedian. He coached her. He told her, he said, your ugliest sin, your gimmick is clothes and wigs. And she got a fabulous wardrobe for that stage. And he started her doing comedy. And she was very good. Because she left there when we closed the show out. She went to Vegas, and she was with him a long time. She did some of his Sanford and Son shows, and she was still out there. But we came home because we didn't feel right taking his money, four of us. So we went to pick up our last pay in Vegas, and he said, stick around all day, you know, play at the casino, think about it, you know. Think about it. You want to get you all a room so you can think about it. And then you can maybe go back up to La Cienega. So we said, no, we're going home. So Sonny Allen bought a Cadillac, a big Cadillac. In fact, it was Nancy Wilson's car. He was on the lot one day looking for a Cadillac, and she was selling her car. So he bought her old Cadillac. And we drove home. We took our time. We drove home, and we would stop at night and go to drive-in theaters. He was the only one driving, so he was the one that had to sleep. So we would go to drive-in theaters at night in different towns. We came back to New York by the song Route 66. So every stop in there, that's where we stopped and slept the night. And we had a great ride home. It was a good trip, even though it turned out the way it did. But it was a really good experience for us. Any more questions? Yes.